To awake, to awaken. To awaken from the illusion is then to undergo a radical change of consciousness with regard to one's own existence. It is to cease being under the impression that you are just poor little me. To find out who you really are, or what you really are, behind the mask. When I was a small boy, I used to haunt that section of London around the British Museum. And one day I came across a shop which had a notice over the window which said philosophical instruments. Even as a boy, I knew something about philosophy, but I couldn't imagine what philosophical instruments could be. So I went up to the window, and there displayed were chronometers, slide rules, scales, and all kinds of what we would now call scientific instruments. Because science used to be called natural philosophy. Because, as Aristotle says, the beginning of philosophy is wonder. Philosophy is man's expression of curiosity about everything, his attempt to make sense of the world primarily through his intellect. Now, I'm particularly interested in the attitude of the family to children. Because we have an absolutely extraordinary attitude in our culture and in various other cultures, high civilizations, to the new member of human society. Instead of saying frankly to children, "How do you do? Welcome to the human race. We are playing a game. And we are playing by the following rules. We want to tell you what the rules are so that you'll know your way around. And when you've understood what rules we're playing by, when you get older, you may be able to invent better ones." But instead of that, we still retain an attitude to the child that he is on probation. He's not really a human being. He's a candidate for humanity. And in just this way, we have a whole system of preparation of the child for life, which always is preparation and never actually gets there. In other words, we have a system of schooling which starts with grades. And we get this little creature into the thing with a kind of, "Come on, kitty, kitty, kitty." And we get it always preparing for something that's going to happen. So you go into nursery school as preparation for kindergarten. You go into kindergarten as preparation for first grade. And then you see you go up the grades till you get to high school. And then comes a time when maybe if we can get you fascinated enough with the system, you go to college. And then when you go to college, if you're smart, you get into graduate school and stay a perpetual student and go back to be a professor and just go round and round in the system. But in the ordinary way, they don't encourage quite that. They want you after graduate school or after graduation, commencement as it's called, beginning to get out into the world with a capital W. And so you know, you've been trained for this and now you've arrived. But when you get out into the world at your first sales meeting, they've got the same thing going again because they want you to make that quota. And if you do make it, they give you a higher quota. And come along about the 45 years of age, maybe you're vice president. And you suddenly it dawns on you that you've arrived. With a certain sense of having been cheated because it is just the same as things. Life feels the same as it always felt. And you are conditioned to be in desperate need of a future. So the final goal that this culture prepares for us is called retirement. When you will be a senior citizen and you will have the wealth and the leisure to do what you've always wanted, but you will at the same time have impotence, a rotten prostate, and false teeth, and no energy. So the whole thing, from beginning to end, is a hoax. And furthermore, some other aspects of the hoax, just for kicks. you are involved, by and large, in a very strange business system, which divides your day into work and play. Work is something that everybody does, and you get paid to do it because nobody could care less about doing it. In other words, it is so abominable and boring that you can get paid for doing it. And the object of doing this is to make money. And the object of making money is to go home and enjoy the money that you've made. When you've got it, you see, you can buy pleasure. And this is a complete fallacy. Money never can buy pleasure, because all pleasures depend upon not putting down a symbol of power, money, but upon disciplines. In other words, now in Sausalito, where I live, we have pier after pier full of fine boats, motor cruisers, sailing boats, all sorts of things, which nobody ever uses, because they've been bought on the falling for the ad line that if you buy this thing, you will have pleasure, you will have status, you will have something or other. And then they spend the evening looking at an electronic reproduction of life, which is divided from you by a glass screen. You can't touch it, you can't smell it. Then you look at this thing, and you have a strange feeling, you see, that the whole procession of grades that was leading to something in the future, to that goody, that gorgeous, voluptuous goody that was lying at the end of the line, it never quite turns up. What I am saying is that making plans for the future is of use only to people who are capable of living completely in the present. Because when you make plans for the future and they mature, if you can't live in the present, you are not able to enjoy the future for which you have planned. Because you will have in you a kind of syndrome, whereby happiness consists in promises and not in direct and immediate realizations. We condition the child in a way that sets the child a life problem which is insoluble and therefore attended by constant frustration. And as a result of this problem being insoluble, it is perpetually postponed to the future, so that one is educated to live in the future, and one is not ever educated to live today. And that you are not something that comes into this world on probation and doesn't really belong. This is, you see, the attitude that we foster in the child. But that you are something not that comes into the world, but comes out of it. In the same way as a flower comes out of a plant or a fruit comes out of a tree. That you are an expression. You, as a human being, are a symptom of nature. And that you really belong there, and that, furthermore, your actual self, what is finally and fundamentally you, is not a separate and lonely part of the world, but the real you is the world itself, everything that there is, expressing itself as this particular organism here and now, and of course, as you look across the room, as all these other organisms in their here and now, we are all rays from the same sun. Or let me put it in a simpler way. Supposing that every night you could dream any dream you wanted to dream, what would you do? Well, first of all, I'm quite sure that most of us would dream all the marvelous things we wanted to happen. We would fulfill all our wishes, and we might go on that way for months. Besides, you could make it extraordinarily rich by wishing to dream 75 years in one night, full of glorious happenings. But after you had done that for a few months, you might begin to get a little tired of it. And you would say, what about an adventure tonight, in which something terribly exciting and rather dangerous is going to happen? But I'll know I'm dreaming, so it won't be too bad. And I'll wake up if it gets too serious. So you do that for a while. You rescue princesses in distress from dragons and all sorts of things. And then when you've done that for some time, you say, now let's go out a bit further. Let's forget it's a dream and have a real thrill. Ooh. But you know you'll wake up. And then you get
After you've done that for a while, you get more and more nerve until you sort of dare yourself as to how far out you can get. And you end up dreaming the sort of life you're living now.